Hey guys, welcome back, and today we will be discussing about congenital hypothyroidism. If you like the content of my channel, please subscribe and share it among your friends, colleagues and juniors so they can learn with us. There have been multiple questions on hypothyroidism, especially congenital hypothyroidism, and our line of discussion also will be closely following that of the questions asked. So we will cover the synthesis, development, what changes happen in utero and what happens after birth, both in term and preterm. We will see about causes of congenital hypothyroidism, how are you going to screen, investigate for the underlying etiology and management. Why are we worried about congenital hypothyroidism? Worldwide, this is one of the most common causes of preventable mental retardation, because if you initiate a thyroxine supplementation early, then this child can have almost a normal neurodevelopment in comparison with its peers. And most babies are asymptomatic at birth. You will not be able to tell this baby has hypothyroidism just by seeing. For the symptoms to develop, it takes some time. So the detection is only by means of screening. That's why we are encouraging universal newborn screening, at least for diseases like congenital hypothyroidism. The incidence worldwide is around 1 in 2,000 to 1 in 5,000. But what about in India? This ICMR study published in Indian Journal of Pediatrics in 2018, this was a study conducted in 5 metropolitan cities, screening around 1 lakh babies, 20,000 from each unit, who are more than 34 weeks of gestation. If you see that the incidence in India is very high, the prevalence is around 1 in 722. And even if you reduce or remove all the transient causes of hypothyroidism, the incidence is still high at 1 in approximately 1000. And all the more reason for us to screen all our babies for congenital hypothyroidism. If you see the embryology, the thyroid gland is an endodermal structure. Okay, it originates from the endoderm, from the base of tongue, from foramen cecum, a duct falls below or grows down, which is called as thyroglossal duct. Initially, the thyroid is a bilobed gland, and later it stretches out. It forms the lateral parts. The lateral parts are also contributed by fourth pharyngeal pouch. By these lateral enlarges, they form C cells and solid nests of cells that will support the formation of lateral lobes of thyroid. And together, they form the thyroid gland with isthmus, two lateral lobes. By 7 weeks of gestation, it is in its final place. What are the clinical implications? If the thyroid is not formed at all, you call as athyreosis. If the thyroid is less formed, then you call it as hypoplasia. If it is in an abnormal location along the descent of thyroglossal cyst, then you call it as ectopy. The most common location of ectopy will be a lingual thyroid. Many genes are implicated, like NKX2.1, NKX2.2, FOXE1, PAX8, etc. But when you go and do a genetic study, only 2% of thyroid dysgenesis have these genetic defects. And almost all ectopic thyroids are hypothyroid. So this thyroid gland has formed. How is it synthesizing a thyroid gland? There are cuboidal cells which surround a colloid, and together it is called as a follicle. Whenever there is increased secretion, the cells increase in size and the amount of colloid reduces because the colloid gets secreted into the circulation. In the cell, what happens? From blood, the iodide has to go in by sodium iodide symporter. And from the cell into the colloid, the iodide gets in by means of a chloride iodide exchanger, which is also called as pendrin. This iodide has to get converted to iodine for further formation of thyroxine. And for that, peroxidase enzyme is very, very important. This iodine will get incorporated into thyroglobulin. What is thyroglobulin? Thyroglobulin is a protein that is formed inside the thyroid cell, and it has approximately 70 tyrosine amino acid residues. There are other structures also which form thyroglobulin. The salivary gland, the gastric mucosa, the placenta, etc. Okay. Thyroglobulin, these also have sodium iodide symporter. So, yeah, coming back to it, sorry, I digressed a little. So, this thyroglobulin, which is formed inside the cell, has 70 tyrosine residues. So, iodine gets incorporated into this thyroglobulin molecule, okay, and it couples with the tyrosine residues inside, forming mono diiodothyronine residues. If one mono and one di get together, then it is T3. If two dis get together, then it is T4. If MIT and DIT couple together, then it is T3. If DIT and MIT couple together, it is reverse T3. Okay. This thyroglobulin stays inside the colloid along with all your mono, di, tri, and tetraiodothyronines till there is a need for secretion of thyroxine. So, whenever there is a THS stimulation, what happens? This thyroglobulin gets inside by means of pinocytosis. There is lysosomal fusion and there is removal of the thyroxine molecules from thyroglobulin. The T3 and T4 get into circulation, whereas the mono and diiodothyronines get reutilized by means of deiodinases. It gets split into iodide and tyrosines. This iodine will again get reutilized for synthesis, and tyrosine will get reutilized for thyroglobulin synthesis. Okay, note that peroxidase is important for the conversion of iodide to iodine. It is important for thyroglobulin incorporation. It is important for coupling. Okay. So this T4, which gets secreted outside, will get converted to T3, which is the active form of thyroid hormone in the periphery by means of deiodinase enzyme. T3 goes into the cell and by intracellular signaling mechanisms gives the effects of thyroxine that we see clinically. So in each step there can be problem, and these problems will lead to hypothyroidism. So if there is a problem in iodide trapping, then there will be hypothyroidism. Suppose there is very less iodine, there is no iodine to trap, then the child will have hypothyroidism. What about too much iodine? This too much iodine also will inhibit iodide trapping, but this trapping will be only for some time. This is called as Wolff-Chaikoff effect. And the iodide or the thyroxine secretion will reduce. After some time, there will be an escape phenomenon. So even despite the increased iodide concentration, the thyroid will escape this inhibition and it will start secreting thyroxine again. For this escape to happen, there needs to be a gestational age or gestational maturity of at least 36 to 40 weeks. So in a premature baby, less than 36 weeks, if there is too much iodide due to whatever reason, then this child, due to Wolff-Chaikoff effect, will have hypothyroidism. So what about a defect in chloride iodide exchanger, which is Pendrin? Then you have Pendred syndrome, where there is hypothyroidism along with sensorineural hearing loss. The conversion of iodide to iodine is called as organification. So if there is a defect in peroxidase enzyme, then there is almost absent thyroid synthesis because only iodine can combine with your thyroglobulins. For this conversion, the H2O2 or hydrogen peroxide is also required. If there is a deficiency, it can lead to transient hypothyroidism. If there is a problem in incorporation of iodine, then hypothyroidism. If there is a problem in coupling, again hypothyroidism. If there is a problem in secretion into circulation, this problem generally happens if there is a central hypothyroidism. Although TSH is required for all the steps, the most important step that it manages is actually secretion of the thyroxine into circulation. Deiodinase, there are three types: type 1, type 2, and type 3. Type 2 is concentrated in pituitary and cerebral cortex, whereas type 1 is present in all tissues except brain. Both of them are important for formation of T3, which is the active form of enzyme. And type 3 forms reverse T3, which is inactive. See, type 2 gains very much importance, especially in fetus, because even though the baby is hypothyroid everywhere else in the body, but the brain concentrates whatever T4 is present into T3, concentration happens in the brain. So the brain's requirement for T3 is satisfied and the neurodevelopment is not much affected, at least in utero. What happens in a fetus and a neonate? So now you saw how the thyroid was formed, how it was secreted and synthesized. What happens in a baby? In utero, First of all, mother will increase the secretion of her own thyroxine, okay, because she has to transfer some to the baby. The placenta allows transfer of only these three things: iodine, thyroid releasing hormone, not stimulating, note that this is releasing hormone, and T4, okay. T4 crosses the placenta very well, and approximately there is a 40% increase in secretion of mother's thyroxine to accommodate for this increase in transfer. Okay, all the T4 does not get into the fetus because it gets modulated by placental type 3 deiodinase, which converts the T4 into reverse T3. Why is this important? Because first 12 weeks the baby is not having any thyroxine secretion of its own. But what about neurodevelopment? The brain is still developing in the baby, isn't it? So for that to develop, you need the maternal T4 transfer. If the mother is deficient, if she is not able to increase her thyroxine secretion, what happens then? She will not be able to transfer to the baby, because only source of thyroxine for the first 12 weeks will be maternal T4. If the mother is deficient, this baby will go on to have mental retardation in the future, even if you supplement T4 after the baby is born. That is the importance of maternal transfer. That is why if a mother is a known case of hypothyroid, what do? The obstetricians increase the thyroxine dose by 30 to 50%. Suppose mother is not a known hypothyroid, the first test they advise will be a thyroid screen, because you need to supplement the mother as early as possible. What are the other things that can transfer? The other things that can transfer are antithyroid drugs and antithyroid antibodies. Antithyroid drugs, methimazole crosses better compared to propylthiouracil, because propylthiouracil is protein bound. Okay. Methimazole, if given in the first trimester, can cause aplasia cutis congenita, tracheoesophageal fistula, and choanal atresia. Remember that. That is why first trimester generally the hypothyroid or hyperthyroid mothers are given propylthiouracil, and second trimester onwards methimazole is given. Antithyroid antibodies can cross placenta. Depending upon whether it's stimulating or inhibiting, the baby will manifest the symptoms. T4, as we discussed, that will be the only source of thyroxine in first trimester for the fetus, and the medication dose will be increased in the mother. So what happens in the fetus? Fetus has to start synthesizing thyroglobulin by around 4 to 6 weeks of age. Thyroid releasing hormones will start by around 6 to 8 weeks, and it will start trapping iodide by around 8 to 12 weeks of gestation. The fetal T3, T4, TSH, all of these will start after 12 weeks. Why after 12 weeks? Because you need at least these three things before a thyroxine can be synthesized, isn't it? So a thyroglobulin is important, the iodide getting in is important. If both are there, and if there is a TSH stimulation, then the thyroid can synthesize T3 and T4. So if you note, first 12 weeks, there is no T4. The only T4 source will be mother. For the negative feedback mechanism to happen, it starts to mature only by 26 weeks of gestation. So even if there is too much T3 or too much T4, there will not be a feedback mechanism to the hypothalamus and to the pituitary. It becomes fully functional only after birth, only 1 to 2 months after birth. Okay. So what we discussed earlier, TRH starts by around 6 to 8 weeks. TSH starts later, but it remains low up till around 12 weeks. After that, if you see, there is a upward growth, isn't it so? It reaches the term level of 6 to 8 milli international units only towards 38-40 weeks of gestation. T3 remains low till 30 weeks. See, T3 starts around mid gestation and increases well only after 30 weeks. And there is no feedback inhibition because there is immaturity of hypothalamopituitary axis. So if you note this, in birth, there is a stress of the delivery. The baby is delivered into a relatively cold environment compared to in utero, and there is cord clamping. All of this will stimulate the hypothalamus to secrete TRH. TRH will stimulate the pituitary to secrete TSH. What happens to TSH? There is an immediate peak. Okay, at 30 minutes of birth, there will be a TSH surge. of about 60 to 80 milli international units per liter, and it comes to normal by around 3 to 5 days, or at least the normal for that age. T4 and T3 will start increasing after the TSH increases, isn't it? So TSH is the one which is going to stimulate the thyroid gland. So after 24 to 48 hours, there will be a peak, and T4 and T3 slowly gets to normal by 1 to 2 weeks. TSH comes to normal by 3 to 5 days, and T4 and T3 come to normal by 1 to 2 weeks. What about preterms? Preterms also follow the same curves, but the absolute values are very, very less. Okay. So imagine if you do a blood investigation immediately at birth, like you do a cord blood. If you do a cord blood, what are you going to see? You're going to see a very high TSH because there is a TSH surge, isn't it so? And what about T4? Okay, madam, TSH is high, but we can still do T4, isn't it so? Because T4 surges later. Correct, you can still do T4, but remember the mother is still giving her T4 to the baby. Till birth, approximately 40% of whatever thyroxine the baby has is that of mother's. So if you do a T4, the value is not just reflective of the fetus, it is also reflective of the mother. Okay. And the T half is around 7 to 10 days. So even if this baby is actually having a hypothyroidism, you may not be able to pick up the low T4 values because of these maternal transfer. Okay. And the baby remains asymptomatic for first 2 weeks or so because the T half is around 1 to 2 weeks. That is why the initiation of treatment is very, very important. You will initiate before 2 weeks because till then you have some amount of protection from the maternal T4, and after that it is lost. There are multiple problems with prematurity and multiple reasons why the hormones in premature babies do not very much follow that of term babies. Multiple reasons, as I have mentioned. There is hypothalamic pituitary immaturity. The baby is born early, so there is loss of maternal transfer. And the baby is not having too much reserve in the thyroid gland. Because the thyroid gland per se is small, it has not grown to its big size. And there is iodine imbalance. There may be deficiency of iodine, or there may be too much iodine. Too much iodine, as in the baby's skin can absorb your iodine preparations that you use to clean. Okay, the cleansers which have iodine can still be absorbed by the baby, and this will lead to Wolff-Chaikoff effect and hypothyroidism. Plus, most preterm babies, extremely preterm babies, will be very sick, and due to this reason, there can be delayed surge in TSH and delayed rise in TSH, which will be missed if you do not look for it. So premature problems can be divided broadly into two. One will be transient hypothyroxemia of prematurity, and the other will be delayed TSH surge. Okay. TOP, or transient hypothyroxemia, happens in the first 2 weeks, and it is characterized usually by low T4 values, but normal TSH, or the value is actually not the correct response that you expect for a low T4, isn't it so? When you have a low T4, you want the pituitary to increase the stimulating hormone secretion, but it does not happen. This happens approximately in 20% in less than 34 weekers and 30% in less than 32 weekers, and so on and so forth. It can be even up to 85% in very, very preterm babies. You will treat this transient hypothyroxemia only if there is a TSH elevation. Otherwise, you wait, you repeat the test in 1 to 2 weeks, and you see how the child is responding, and then you decide on treatment. If there is a clear-cut sign of hypothyroidism, then you initiate. Otherwise, you do not initiate treatment. What about delayed TSH surge? Delayed TSH surge is when you do a first screening at 48 to 72 hours, you see a normal TSH. But when you do a second screening, you do a second screening in these high-risk babies at 2 weeks of age, 2 to 4 weeks. So if you do a second screening, you find elevated TSH. This can happen in 12% of preterms, and the problem usually resolves by around 6 to 10 weeks. What about the control of thyroid hormone synthesis? I think we discussed it in bits and pieces, but to put it all together, if there is a stimulation to hypothalamus, like a cold stress, it increases secretion of thyrotropin-releasing hormone, which stimulates the anterior pituitary to produce thyroid-stimulating hormone, which stimulates the thyroid by increasing its size and vascularity to produce thyroxine, just T4 especially and T3, and thyroxine acts on cells to produce its effects. And for thyroxine synthesis, you need iodine. Now you know the anatomy, now you know the physiology, now you know what changes happen in utero, what changes happen after the birth, both in premature and term babies. So what will be the causes with all of these together? Permanent cause and transient cause. Among permanent, you are worried more about a thyroid problem. Is the thyroid formed properly? If the thyroid is formed properly, is it functioning properly? These are the two things you will think about. Suppose thyroid is formed properly and it is functioning properly, but there is no stimulation from the higher authorities. There is a problem in pituitary and hypothalamus, or those are also functioning properly, but the receptor that receives the TSH is not functioning properly. Okay. Suppose all of these are fine, but there is a problem after secretion. There is a thyroxine resistance. There is a problem in functioning of the thyroxine because it is not able to get into cells. Like neurons, it is not able to get into neurons because of a monocarboxylate transporter deficiency. All of these can cause a permanent cause of hypothyroidism. What about transient causes? Transient causes are when there is too much iodine or too little iodine, if there are antithyroid drugs, if there are some stimulating or inhibiting antibodies. See, transient causes usually resolve by themselves and you may not need to do anything, especially if it is due to antithyroid drugs. Okay, it will stay there only for 7 to 10 days in circulation till the half-life is over. After that, once the effect wears off, then the baby's thyroid will take up its usual function. So, primary thyroid problem, it can be an abnormal formation or an abnormal functioning. Abnormal formation can be ectopic, can be hypoplasia, or it can be complete athyreosis. If it is dysharmonogenesis, in different stages of thyroid hormone secretion, there can be a defect. What are the most common or most severe ones that you need to know about? Most common cause of congenital hypothyroidism is dysgenesis. And among dysgenesis, it will be ectopic thyroid. If it is dyshormonogenesis, it is thyroid peroxidase deficiency. But the most severe among them will be a thyroglobulin mutation. Because thyroglobulin is very, very integral to formation of T4 and T3. If that is deficient, then the baby will have fetal goiter and severe hypothyroidism. With all of these in mind, you know, even if the child is going to be very much hypothyroid, they may not manifest symptoms. They are clinically asymptomatic. So you will have to find them out only by newborn screening. The window to initiate will be only 2 weeks. So you need to screen, rescreen if required, confirm, initiate treatment. So for newborn screening, when do you ideally do? You do it after 48 to 72 hours because there is initial TSH surge. And you don't want to do it in the initial periods. Suppose you have to do it early, it can be at least 24 to 48 hours and not within 24 hours. If it is a sick neonate, extreme preterm babies, you can do it by 7 days. You will ideally use a capillary blood sample from heel prick for screening. And for confirmation, you do a venous sampling. The drops will be put upon specialized filter paper. It will be dried at room temperature and shipped off to a central lab where they can look at TSH or T4 values, whichever you are looking for. TSH and T4. There are two methods of screening. A TSH driven screening and a T4 driven screening. In screening methods, usually concentrate on primary hypothyroidism or a problem in the thyroid gland. So what do you expect the TSH to happen? TSH should increase appropriately to counteract for the decrease in T4. T4 will be reduced in, of course, hypothyroidism. But there are advantages and disadvantages with both methods of screening, and I will touch upon them briefly. So if you do a TSH based screening, you want a TSH above some particular cutoff value for you to screen the babies, isn't it so? What happens? You can detect even mild or subclinical cases of hypothyroidism because in them the T4 will be normal, but the pituitary is functioning more to push out that amount of T4. When you do a TSH based screening, you will pick up that increased TSH value. But what about the disadvantage? You will miss central hypothyroidism because you are looking at only increased TSH values and not decreased TSH values. And if there is a delayed TSH rise, then you will miss those group of babies also, because the screening is going to be within 2 weeks, isn't it? So delayed TSH rise starts by around only 2 to 6 weeks of age. So these are about advantages and disadvantages of TSH based screening. What about T4 based screening? When you do a T4 based screening, if the T4 is low, you can detect primary, you can detect secondary hypothyroidism, you can detect babies with delayed TSH elevation, because in them T4 will be low. So those group of babies also will gather into your T4. But what about the disadvantages? You will miss the subclinical hypothyroidism because T4 levels in them are near normal due to increased activity of pituitary. In India, we tend to do a TSH based screening because it is considered more sensitive. So this is based upon the Indian Society for Pediatric and Adolescent Endocrinology guidelines. With heel prick or cord blood, preferably heel prick at 48 to 72 hours of age, you do a TSH screening. Okay. Suppose you have to do it at less than 48 hours, 24 to 48 hours, the cutoff value will be different. If it is more than 48 hours, TSH cutoff for you calling back or you retesting will be 20. If the baby is screened at 24 to 48 hours, then the cutoff value is 34. Okay. So more than 34 at 24 to 48 hours or more than 20 at 48 hours and later, you consider them to retest. Okay. When you are retesting, you see that the TSH value is again high. It is above 20, but it is between 20 to 40. You recall them at 7 to 10 days of life because you want to settle the reasons for this raised TSH if at all something is present. You do a repeat TSH at 7 to 10 days of life and see what happens. If it is still high, if it is still high at more than 20 milli international units at less than 2 weeks of age or more than 10 international units at more than 2 weeks of age, then you need to do a venous sampling. And whenever you do a venous sampling, don't again do just TSH. Do the complete thyroid function test, the TSH, T4, and if possible, free T4 also. Okay. Suppose the TSH value is above 40 in the second screening. What do? You don't again call them. You directly go for the confirmatory venous sample. If the TSH is more than 80, then what you do, you still do a confirmatory venous sampling immediately, but you initiate treatment immediately after doing a venous sample. You don't wait for the results. Whereas in more than 40 and in 20 to 40, you wait for the results of the confirmatory test before initiating on treatment, because without confirmation of hypothyroidism, do not initiate treatment. Okay. But you can start treatment without trying to find the etiology. Both are different. Okay. Note that. You need not have the etiology of hypothyroidism to initiate treatment, okay? But you need to confirm hypothyroidism before starting treatment. So now you have taken this confirmatory venous sample, okay, for all those elevated TSH, 20 to 40, more than 40 and more than 80. So how are you going to see or interpret the results? If the T4 and TSH are normal, then the child is normal. You don't have to worry. If the T4 is low, okay, T4 is low with or without raised TH, then you know there is definitely hypothyroidism, okay, be it due to whatever cause, but the T4 is low, so you need to start treatment. Suppose the T4 is normal, but you find there is high TSH, then this is a dicey case where you are thinking this is subclinical hypothyroidism, where the thyroid stimulating hormone has to work hard. In this case, you can repeat TSH after 2 weeks, see the TSH values, and depending upon the elevation, you can start treatment. If the TSH is going to be persistently high, more than 10 milli international units after 3 weeks, then you start treatment and you reassess at 3 years of age. See, at every step, ideal is to include the consultation of a pediatric endocrinologist. Okay. Because they will be able to guide us better rather than guidelines. Guidelines are just that. They are just going to point you in the right direction. Okay. But for the finer management, we need the endocrinologist's input. Okay. To sum up the screening, so any TSH value more than 20 after 48 hours, between 24 to 48 hours, more than 34 milli international units, you will rescreen immediately. And if you rescreen, depending upon the value, you decide upon what to do. If it is 24 to 40, you know 20 to 40, it is a raised value, call them after 1 week, rescreen. If it is more than 40, depending upon whether it is between 40 to 80 or above 80, you are going to decide on treatment. If it is 40 to 80, you do a direct confirmatory test with venous sample. If it is above 80, you do a confirmatory test and start treatment without waiting for results. And depending upon result, you are going to initiate treatment or withhold treatment and wait and watch. Most of these cases, after initiating treatment, at least try to find the etiological diagnosis. Okay. If there is time, you can find the etiology and start treatment, but try not to delay treatment by more than a few days. Okay. Reassessment will be required at 3 years of age, especially for children with dysharmonogenesis. A thyroid dysgenesis is a permanent hypothyroidism, whereas dysharmonogenesis may or may not be. Hence, the requirement for reassessment at 3 years of age. Interpretation of results we saw already. Low T4 with elevated TSH, there is definitely a thyroid problem, thyroid congenital hypothyroidism. If there is normal T4 and elevated TSH, it can be an evolving hypothyroidism, a subclinical hypothyroidism. If it is low T4 and normal or low TSH, then it is a pituitary problem. It can also be transient hypothyroxemia in preterm babies. It can be thyroid binding globulin defect. All of this require the endocrinologist's hand. If there is low T4 and delayed TSH elevation, you need to monitor TSH for the first few weeks before depending upon initiation of treatment. So, when will you rescreen babies? This is another common question, another common doubt. Because you have very sick babies, you have very preterm babies, multiple births, or you are doing sampling within 24 hours, or very sick babies. In these situations, what happens is the first test may or may not be indicative of the actual thyroid status because of all the extra factors that are happening in the baby. So in these high-risk children, at least, we need to rescreen them at 2 weeks of age to actually know what is happening. So now that you know this child has hypothyroidism, how are you going to detect what caused this hypothyroidism? So you can either start with a thyroid scan directly or you can do a ultrasound and then proceed. So we will see how we do with a thyroid scan in the first place. What is thyroid scan going to tell? It is going to tell whether the thyroid is uptaking the contrast or not. So if the thyroid is uptaking the contrast, it means some thyroid gland is present. Okay. See if it is present in the normal location or abnormal location. If it is in normal location, then the thyroid is present. It is taking in the contrast, iodine contrast, but it is not giving out any thyroxine. It means there is a dysharmonogenesis. Suppose it is not taking the iodine contrast at all. Then do an ultrasound thyroid to look to see whether there is a thyroid in the first place. If thyroid is absent, then you know you can't do anything about it. Thyroid is present, but the contrast is not taking up. Why is it? Is it due to a receptor problem or is it due to a thyroid gland problem per se, not taking the contrast? Do a receptor antibodies and see if there is maternal transfer. If it is present, then you know these antibodies will go off on its own and the thyroid will start functioning. Suppose it is absent, then you know that there is a synthetic defect, dysharmonogenesis. Ultrasound thyroid based screening or investigation for evaluation of underlying cause of hypothyroidism. So, if you do ultrasound thyroid, see if there is a thyroid or not. Suppose there is no thyroid, then you know this thyroid tissue is absent, at least in the normal location. To know if there is some thyroid anywhere up or down below, do a thyroglobulin levels. Thyroglobulin level, if it is present, it will tell that there is some thyroid tissue somewhere, probably ectopic thyroid, and you can do a radioisotope scanning to localize it. If there are no thyroglobulins, then you know this thyroid gland is absent. Suppose you are doing a ultrasound thyroid and you see a gland in the normal location, but it is very small. Again, you do a thyroglobulin. Depending upon thyroglobulin, then you do a radioisotope scan. Then you know if the thyroid gland is producing thyroglobulin or functioning or not. And if it is functioning, is it taking in the contrast or not? So you know if there is a receptor mutation or a antibody formation. Suppose you have a normal sized gland. In the normal location, you took a thyroglobulin, it is normal. So thyroid gland is producing thyroglobulin, it is present in normal size also. You do a scan, the uptake is slow. Uptake low again can be because of antithyroid antibodies or antithyroid drugs. Suppose the ultrasound thyroid, contrary to what you are expecting, is showing some enlarged gland. Enlarged gland is due to the thyroid secreting some amount of thyroxine, but it is not able to put it out into circulation. Even then, there can be a normal or enlarged gland. So you do again a thyroglobulin levels. If it is abnormal, then there is a thyroglobulin gene mutation. If it is normal, then you do a scan to differentiate. If it is absent uptake or high uptake. If there is a high uptake, see perchlorate discharge. If it is a normal perchlorate discharge, then you have a DHAL1 defect. If it is a positive perchlorate discharge, then everything else. Your thyroid peroxidase, your pendrin, your DuOX2, which is required for hydrogen peroxide problem. Okay. Easier way will be to do an ultrasound thyroid, a thyroglobulin and a radio contrast to see what is happening. These are the tests you will need to evaluate the cause for hypothyroidism. What other investigations you can do? You can do a urinary iodine levels. If there is low iodine in urine, you know there is iodine deficiency. If it is high, you know this baby has been exposed to iodine containing antiseptics or too much iodine in the mother, etc. You should screen for associated anomalies, because compared to a 3% of congenital anomalies in normal newborn population, there is increased or 10% incidence of congenital anomalies, and most common will be a heart defect, and there can be 20% association with hearing loss. So you need to screen for these two. So now you have found out this baby has hypothyroidism and you are evaluating or already evaluated the cause for hypothyroidism. You need to initiate this child on management. What are your treatment goals? Immediate goals will be to normalize T4 within 2 weeks and normalize TSH within 4 weeks or 2 to 4 weeks. The long-term goal will be to at least make the child reach the physical and mental growth for the baby's genetic potential. Okay. Starting thyroid hormone should never be delayed by more than a few days to evaluate cause. Establish the baby has hypothyroidism and start on treatment. And delay in normalizing T4 and TSH is associated with lower IQ points. So early treatment initiation, proper dosage treatment initiation, and monitor to make sure T4 and TSH are normalizing as early as possible. So you will initiate within 2 weeks. Okay. Why is this 2 weeks very important? This study in 1972, before the pre-screening era, it's in the pre-screening era. If you see, the later the baby was diagnosed and initiated on treatment, the IQ kept on dropping to from 89 at 3 months to 71 at 3 to 6 months to 34 if diagnosed and started after 6 months of treatment. Hence the urgency. So what are you going to give? You're going to give levothyroxine. Why can't we give T3 directly? See, anyways, T4 you give will get converted to T3, isn't it so? By deiodinase enzyme. So you don't have to worry about giving the active form of thyroxine. The levothyroxine is available as tablet form. Outside, it is also available as a liquid formulation in few countries. Here in India, we generally use a tablet form, which is crushed and mixed with breast milk formula or water. And from a dropper, it can be placed on the cheek pad of the child. Avoid giving calcium, iron, soy protein formula, sucralfates, because these will decrease the absorption of thyroxine. It is ideal on an empty stomach, but very young babies, it is very difficult. So you can continue the regular feeding schedule. Dosage is at 10 to 50 microgram per kg per day as the initial dose. And higher dosages will be for more severe hypothyroidism. And the goal is to reduce or normalize T4 within first 2 to 3 days, and TSH is 2 to 4 weeks. I think I made a mistake in the previous slide telling more, both are 2 weeks, isn't it so? I'm sorry for that, guys, if I have made a mistake. T4 has to be normalized in days, TSH should be normalized in weeks, 2 to 4 days and 2 to 4 weeks. So dosage in this study, which was published in Clinical Endocrinology in 2008, they tried treating different conditions with different dosages. Athyreosis, which is the most severe form where there is no thyroid at all, was started at the highest dose, and dyshormonogenesis was started at a lower dosages. And they found that the follow-up values were almost similar to that of what you initiate earlier. Monitoring intervals after starting is very, very important because we need to avoid both under and over treatment. In fact, over treatment in a few studies have been shown to be associated with mental retardation, which is what you are trying to prevent, isn't it so? So avoid over treatment too. So after initiating treatment 2 weeks and 4 weeks after, then in the first 6 months, every 1 to 2 months, 6 months to 3 years, every 3 to 4 months, then after that, 6 to 12 months. Okay, this 3 years is very, very important because this is the age at which we reassess. And if you are going to change the thyroxine dose at any point in time, you need to reevaluate at 4 weeks to make sure your targets are achieved. What are your targets then? TSH ideally should be less than 5 microunits per deciliter, optimally between 0.5 to 2. T4 and free T4 in the first 3 years of age should be at 10 to 16 and 1.4 to 2.3. If you can't remember all this, don't worry, the endocrinologist will help you. Just remember, the T4 values has to be maintained at upper half of normal range. This is very, very important. When to consider permanent hypothyroidism? If there is a dysgenesis, dysharmonogenesis in some cases, except like your hydrogen peroxide gene defect, where it can be a transient hypothyroidism. And if at any time in first year of life, the TSH rises above 20 millinational units per liter, despite treatment, you need to consider permanent hypothyroidism. So all of these are after birth. What about in utero? Suppose you somehow come to know this baby is hypothyroid in utero, or you see during a routine scanning that the baby has goiter. Okay, fetal goiters are known. This can be due to a maternal transfer of antibodies or due to drugs, or it can be due to a fetal problem of dysharmonogenesis. Both of these can have fetal goiter. So why are you worried about this fetal goiter? Because it can cause a mechanical obstruction. What is behind the thyroid? Basically your airway, trachea and your esophagus is there. If trachea is compressed, what happens? Your lungs will not develop properly. If esophagus is compressed, what happens? This baby will not swallow amniotic fluid properly and there can be polyhydramnios. So to avoid all that, intra-amniotic injections of L-thyroxine can be given. Note that this is not to normalize the underlying defect of thyroxine secretion in the baby. It is to reduce the size of goiter and prevent mechanical complication. Okay. So in this study where they studied 12 cases of fetal goiter, what they saw was the dosages varied widely from 200 to 800 microgram per injection. Number of injections required varied. The frequency of injection varied. Only good thing was no adverse reactions were noted and thyroid size decreased in nearly 8 to 9 among these 12 cases. Okay, so this is just out of interest, extra point. This is not really required for us. So to sum it all up, you need to know congenital hypothyroidism is a treatable cause. You need to do a universal newborn screening in all babies, preferably at 48 to 72 hours, so that you can initiate treatment by confirmation within 2 weeks. If causes not known, underlying cause, you evaluate but do not treatment on that account, and you need to closely follow up for both under and over treatment of thyroid. So thank you guys for your patient listening. I hope this helped you get an idea about congenital hypothyroidism. I'm sorry it was a very long lecture, couldn't reduce it any further than this. If you have any doubts, please comment down in the box below. I'm not an endocrinologist, but I will ask somebody who knows and I will let you know. Thank you all again. Please subscribe to my channel and share it among your friends. And let us all learn pediatrics together. Thank you.